Hey everybody, welcome back to Rust and Relaxation. As you'll recall, we're going to be resuming our exploration of Ulysseal. Before we do that though, I wanted to just give you guys a look at some of the things I've done off camera. Once again, I just went and ran some errands. I think I might have leveled up a little bit, I don't quite remember, it's been a few days since I recorded this footage. But just wanted to bring everybody up to speed on where we're at this point in time. I've joined the Warriors of Sunlight Covenant and leveled it up to rank 1 so that I could get the Great Lightning Spear Miracle. And I think I mentioned this in the previous episode as well, I leveled my Faith up to 30 to be able to use Sunlight Blade as well as Great Sunlight Spear. I'm sorry, I'm a little bit tired, I've only just woken up, and I want to try and get this done before I have to leave for work. So, let's address a couple of corrections before I get to questions and comments. A number of people pointed out to me that the water in the Sanctuary Guardian boss room does not actually impede your movement. I went back and tested it, and of course you guys are correct. I think what happened there is, I'm so used to the faster running speed in Dark Souls 2, and I'm now also using a mid-roll build in this game, that I think just running around the Sanctuary Guardian boss room, I ended up getting the false sense that my movement was being impeded. It was probably just purely psychological. But that's what happens when you go from game to game, especially games that are as similar as those in the Souls series. The subtle differences can really screw you up. Hi, Calamite! Talk about a one-eyed monster, my god. So, in addition, there are also these guys. We're going to turn the camera around in just a moment, and look at this guy! He thinks he's all Metal Gear Solid dropping down behind me and sneaking up. These guys, of course, are very similar to the Ulysseal Guardians, or the Darkroot Guardians, the green guys, the magical stone golems encountered in Darkroot in the present day. As you probably ascertained from Elizabeth's dialogue in the previous episode, we are quite a ways in the past. This little, I guess, area, the game doesn't treat it as anything more than just a separate series of areas. You can warp to it via bonfire normally, but as far as the lore is concerned, this is about 700 or 800 years before the present time in which the rest of the game takes place. And this area is being basically swallowed by the Abyss. We're going to learn why a little bit later. I'm not going to take time out of the commentary to explain that when a couple of NPCs are going to do the job, probably better than I could. But this area, there's somebody on, I think, Reddit put together a composite image of the map of Darkroot Garden in the present day and the map of this area, and overlaid one onto the other to compare and contrast, because much of the terrain in this area follows the same form as the certain spots in Darkroot Garden in the present day. And I'm going to try and find that composite image, but I've looked for it already and I can't seem to locate it anywhere. So if I'm able to find it before this video goes up, I'll link it in the comments. If not, maybe someone who happens to already know where it is could be kind enough to just post a link in the comments section for everybody's benefit. But as you can see, the enemies here are very different. We have these almost groundskeepers who, before we aggro them, you'll see that they're actually standing at the trees pruning them. Rather futilely, in that all of this area is going to be swallowed by the Abyss. We see these big holes in the ground and this black goo, which is explained at one point, I think, as the Dark of the Abyss. I guess it's just dark can be goo, apparently, in the world of Dark Souls. Don't ask me to explain that, guys, because I have no idea. But before we're actually about to fight Artorias here. Before we do that, I think I went to talk to One of a lot of people's favorite NPCs in Dark Souls 1, Marvelous Chester. And Chester is a really interesting NPC because he also was dragged through time by Manus in order to get here. Let's see what he has to say.
Let me guess. Snatched by a shadowy limb and dragged off to the past? Yes, of course. Exactly what happened to me. We are both strangers in this strange land. But at least now there are two of us. Did you happen across Knight Artorias? The legendary Abyss Walker from the old tales? Well, if you haven't, it's just as well. He's a colorless sort, if you ask me. So, what did that giant mushroom make you do? Not that I care. It's none of my business.
That mask that he's wearing, by the way, is not, in fact, his face. It is a mask. And it's attached to the hat, so very much like Lucatiel's mask and hat in Dark Souls 2. You'll note that he sells a fairly good selection of stuff, but vastly overpriced.
I've little to talk about, really. Oh, you know me. What do I know? So long.
Thanks, Chester, I think. So yeah, something a lot of people forget to do or just never notice before fighting Artorias is opening this shortcut. And I didn't end up having to use it because fortunately, I remembered how to fight Artorias well enough that I was able to beat him on my first try. But for those who aren't, that elevator I just activated goes back up to the first section of Ulysseal Garden and allows you to bypass the run that I just made in order to come here. You just run along the wall and take the elevator back down and you're right here. Wanted to give you guys a quick look at the area ahead and point out that once again, this is one of the things I really love about Demon's Souls and Dark Souls 1 especially, is that you can see very far ahead from certain spots, and typically all of what you can see ahead of you is area that you'll be able to eventually explore. They didn't really do that so much in Dark Souls 2, because they made such heavy use of impossible space, which is something they didn't really do very much of at all in either Demons or Dark 1. But I guess we're gonna just buff up and go fight Artorias. He's a cool guy. I'm not gonna make another Doesn't Afraid of Anything joke. I've already done that once. So this poor guy, he was a hero of Anor Londo, a member of the race of gods. He's not human, as you can see, although he is humanoid, much like most of the other gods, but he is one of Gwyn's four knights who was sent to stop the spread of the Abyss in Ulysseal, which is interesting from a number of standpoints. Lore-wise, it's interesting. This attack, by the way, not really an attack, but it's a buff. And if you don't break his poise and knock him out of it, it will make him far, far stronger. It'll, like, triple his defense, it'll make him hit a lot harder, and it takes forever to wear off. So priority when he starts doing that is knocking him out of it. But It's interesting that Anne Orlando seemed to have some sort of diplomatic relationship with Ulysseel, in that they felt it was worthwhile sending their own knights to try to stop the spread of the Abyss and save the kingdom. Now, ordinarily, I do not like using shields. This build is just sort of a step outside my comfort zone, and it turns out using a shield makes it a lot easier to fight Artorias. If you don't have a shield for this fight, you are solely reliant on skillfully dodging his attacks, which, as you can see, is not easy to do. I really felt like having a shield for this fight kind of trivialized it. And, I mean, he is kind of smart. He will wait until you try to heal before initiating an action. So, again, his AI is kind of similar to the Sanctuary Guardian in that it will, to a certain extent, respond to your actions, but not to the degree that it becomes obnoxious and unreasonable like the NPC invaders in Dark Souls 2. But I should have used Wrath of God from the beginning. It was doing quite a bit more damage to him than my physical attacks. But the Crown of Dusk that I just put on before entering this fight, that stupid-looking headpiece that I'm wearing, I hate the look of it. I hate the ridiculous-looking wings that it puts on the sides of your head. But it boosts the damage of all magic, pyromancy, sorcery, and miracles. So when you combine it with something like the Ring of the Sun's Firstborn, it actually gives you a very significant damage boost to your spells. Which is unfortunate because, again, aesthetically, I hate the way the damn thing looks. But what can you do? So I'm going to get to some questions and comments now. Just because I think I ended up going up to try and open the door to Hawkeye Goff's tower and remembered that I didn't have a key. So, I just thought this one was kind of interesting. East-Westian just made less a question than a comment. Just pointed out that I never shout when things don't go my way in video games. And it's interesting to me that I'm not just someone who uploads Let's Plays. I enjoy watching them as well. Of course, I'm very selective about whom I like to watch, and I'm not really a fan of the people who just scream and shout like idiots. But apparently that's a really common thing to do in the LP world these days, is you can be really successful as a Let's Player if you just scream and yell incoherently about things that make no sense. I'd like to be able to say that I didn't realize how widespread that was, but I can't really claim that. I am aware of it. And this is what I was talking about before, about the dark goo of the Abyss. Apparently, Artorias left this trail as he was making his way back up through the township to the arena where we finally put him out of his misery. This little area here is Dark Souls 1's, I guess you could say, arena? It serves the same function as the arena, but its execution was really poorly thought out. The design of this was not that great. And in some ways, Dark Souls 2 actually did this better. By just having all of the arenas be one versus one, and just have it so that you could just sit at the statue and access the arena no matter what, rather than having to actually... I don't know, I mean, it's sort of similar, but the Dark Souls 2 system had its flaws as well, being completely dependent upon... you had to be in a covenant in order to be able to access it at all. And so I don't know. I guess maybe Dark Souls 2 improved on some things, but not others. Maybe like went backwards in other directions. It's hard to say in as far as the arenas are concerned. I really feel like no Souls game has gotten PvP quite right in terms of organized PvP up to this point. We'll talk a little bit about that later, but... Yeah, no, I don't know, I just... To me, shouting when you're angry is just illogical. It's a waste of energy. It's pointless, it doesn't accomplish anything. It certainly doesn't make me feel any better. Kieran. I think her name is pronounced Kieran. Let's talk to her, because this is one of the reasons I came here. When we speak with her, she'll give us the last set of weapons that I want for this build. And you'll see that Artorias' tassel from his helmet, she's put it on his grave as a tribute.
You. Is that not the soul of the man who fell on this spot? He was a dear friend. I wish to pay proper respect with that soul. Would you be willing to part with it? Thank you. You are very kind. Please take this. I no longer need it. May the Lord guide thee. May the Lord guide thee.
So there is actually a fairly relevant real-life historical reason why Kieran decided to put Artorias' tassel on his grave. And it's as much intertwined with Japanese culture as it is with anything else. The topknot worn by samurai was a symbol of their status, and it represented their honor as samurai. And it's no coincidence that Artorias' helmet had a top knot as well. It's sort of an interesting Japanese touch on the Western influence of the archetypical knight errant. You know, the knight in shining armor with a sword and shield. So there is some significance to her having paid tribute to Artorias in that way. Also interesting are these two weapons that she's given us. These were her weapons. And it seems like both Kieran, who is also one of Gwyn's four knights, and Hawkeye Goth, they basically, Kieran implies, and Goth outright tells you, that they're both kind of done serving as knights. Goth says that he's retired, and Kieran seems to have no more motivation to go on serving now that Artorias is dead, because she was his lover. So we already get to see Anne Orlando well in decline, even so far in the past. And we're not really shown very clearly whether at this point in time Gwyn has already gone off to Link the Fire, or whether he is still actively ruling Anne Orlando at the point in time when we arrive in Ulysseal. I also wanted to illustrate, the Gold Tracer was the first weapon in the Souls series that had a unique offhand moveset, which I will not be using because, in my opinion, its main hand moveset is a little bit better. But the reason it has an offhand moveset, is that you're actually meant to use the Dark Silver Tracer in your main hand. The Dark Silver Tracer is the single best weapon for backstabs in the game now. It has a ridiculous crit modifier, as you'll have noted on the status screen for it. But its strong attacks, not its normal attacks, this is a weird property it has, but its strong attacks will inflict toxin buildup. So, really interesting. But you'll see, these horizontal sweeping swings in the two-handed main hand stance, this is why this weapon is used so much in PvP, because it is so ridiculous, it has such low stamina consumption, it inflicts bleed damage, it has rapid swings, and it's just a really awesome weapon. It does a lot of damage, and I'm going to be using it for quite a while. I'm just going to go back to the bonfire and finish upgrading it. And just a really excellent weapon, and very, very widely used in PvP. And a couple of people had commented that I called it an underdog weapon, and it's not underdog in the sense that it's so heavily used in PvP, What I meant there was that it's an underdog weapon in that it's not the sort of weapon you would expect a paladin build to be using. Most paladin builds tend to be dexterity strength, whereas this one is a little more unusual in being faith strength, where this one is more unusual in that it is faith dexterity. So the Sanctuary Guardian Soul can't actually be used to make anything. So I ate it just now so that I'd have enough souls to buy the Twinkling Titanite necessary to finish upgrading the Gold Tracer. But yeah, I keep interrupting myself. Never got to finish that point about shouting. I guess, though, I didn't really have much more to say. It's just, first of all, I'm not the sort of person who shouts. It's just not me, not my personality. If you can express it by shouting, I feel like you can express it by speaking at an ordinary, reasonable, civilized tone of voice. So...
You come, I forge. We talk. You, good friend. I, very happy.
Aww. There's something just... endearing about this guy. He's just such a nice guy. You know, like, I would totally come here to hang out with him and just chat. I really like this guy. This is one of the things, like, so many of the characters in the Souls, I can't even speak, I'm so tired. Demon Souls and Dark Souls 1, they just have so much personality without even really having to say that much. I figured I'd put a little bit into the Dark Silver Tracer as well, because, it's going to replace my Bandit Knife, since I can use it, I have the stats. But yeah, that's all I have to say about shouting. I'm just not the shouting sort. So, I'm gonna get to some of the other questions I've gotten before I get back to the soul memory discussion, because, a lot of people have expressed some really interesting ideas about what might happen with soul memory in the Game of the Year edition of Dark Souls 2. But I guess kind of on that subject, Keln asks me... he says, essentially, he doesn't understand what the problem is with healing items in Dark Souls 2. And this is one of the other heated debates in the community, is that essentially, Demon Souls started out with a... really, frankly, a very broken healing system. You could get 7 or 8 different types of healing grass, at least 2 of which were instant full heals. And they would just recover all of your HP in literally about a quarter of a second. And one of them would restore all of your negative statuses as well. It would heal them. There were at least 2 others. I think 3 total. Full Moon Grass was a very enormous heal. It was something like 800 HP worth of a heal. And then New Moon and Dark Moon Grass were the instant full heals, and Dark Moon would cure all your negative statuses as well. And all of them stacked to 99. But there were 4 or 5 other types of healing grass as well that you could, very early on, just buy for very cheap. And... you could stockpile enough of it that it kind of trivialized going through the game, assuming you weren't fighting enemies that were killing you in one hit. But healing was broken in Demon's Souls. And especially in PvP, and especially once people discovered the Stockpile Thomas glitch, which allowed you to duplicate infinite amounts of the most overpowered healing grass, we eventually got to the point where you would get into a PvP match and both the invader and the host would just be endlessly munching through stacks of 99 full moon and new moon and dark moon grass, and it was just stupid. Dark Souls 1 largely solved that problem, and I think they would have solved it almost perfectly if they had not given humanity the ability to recover your HP. And here you guys are about to see a really careless, bush league, stupid, noob, casual mistake where I thought I was locked on to the Lucille mage over there, and locked on a little bit too late, and it caused me to roll off a cliff. But Dark Souls 1's healing balance, what they did was, in the beginning, there were very few healing items whatsoever. There were divine blessings, which you only found four or five of in an entire game cycle. So, not really a big deal. You could use those four or five, but there was no way of getting more. You couldn't buy them, you couldn't farm them, so you only basically had that few for essentially emergencies. Divine blessings are an instant full heal, and when I say instant, I literally mean instant in Dark Souls 1. And there were those, but beyond that, your only options for healing are miracles, the Sanctus Shield, which is worthless for healing. It's the only equipment in the game that regenerates your HP. And the regeneration is so slow that it really is, for all intents and purposes, it's useless for that purpose. And then you have your Estus Flask. And then, of course, I guess you have the Evil Eye Ring. I know someone is going to bring that up. And that's actually a much more significant heal than the Sanctus. But you have to kill enemies with that ring and not get hit in order for it to matter. So, as far as healing is concerned, really, for the most part, unless you're using healing miracles, you only have Estus. And your Estus is limited to a maximum of 20 charges. So, until you get the Rite of Kindling, you can only get up to 10 charges with your flask. And even after you have the Rite of Kindling, you still have to dump humanity into bonfires in order to be able to get the full 20 charges. Which is part of the reason that you're seeing me do just that. Every bonfire I arrive at, I'll kindle to max. But Estus is your only really reliably available source of healing in Dark Souls 1, and you cannot use it as either a helper phantom or an invader. So, what happened with that, the balance that they were going for, and that really is the ideal balance for a Souls game, is that they're saying to you, look, you are not meant to just go through this game and YOLO everything. The game is balanced around challenge, and more than that, around making you think. It's a sort of game that you're not meant to just play through brainlessly and tank every situation with your face and just rely on healing items to carry you through it. And you pretty much could do that in Demon's Souls, which is one of that game's greatest flaws. Much as I love it, that aspect of it annoyed even me. Just the endless abundance of healing items and the fact that you could rely on them to get you through pretty nearly any situation. They did away with that in Dark Souls 1, or they would have been able to do away with that if they had not given the humanity item the ability to heal. That was what really broke everything in this game. Estus alone, I think it was a perfect balance, and if they had stuck with just that, you know, the Divine Blessing's fine. But I feel like they give you the ability to gather enough Estus to be able to get you through situations, but you really have to consider carefully when you're going to use that flask, you know? Do you want to use it with 60% of your HP left and potentially waste it? Or do you want to wait till you get hit a little bit more and make the most of it, but risk dying? You know, are you going to use it against enemies in the environment? Or try and conserve as much of it as possible for your boss fights. Because Estus is really precious in boss fights in this game. And that's the other thing about the healing, is that there's supposed to be some consequence to your decisions in the Souls games. And having healing as limited as it is in Dark Souls 1, it adds consequence. There's some weight. W-E-I-G-H-T, by the way. some implication. Just giving you guys a quick look at the silver pendant. This will deflect dark magic when you use it. Really handy item. It's mainly meant for Manus, but you can use it to deflect dark magic cast by other players as well. There's meant to be some consequence to your decisions about using healing magic in the Souls games. Demon Souls did not really achieve that very well. Dark Souls 1 could have achieved it if they had not given you essentially an infinite source of healing that was farmable, which is humanity. And they give you not one, but two different types of humanity. They give you the normal humanity and the twin humanities, which, as you might expect, give you two humanity rather than one when you use them. But although it has a slower animation when you use it than your Estus Flask, humanity is usable as a phantom, both a helper phantom and an invader. So, because you can heal yourself with humanity anytime, and you can carry two stacks of 99 humanity, they essentially went back to having the same damn problem in Dark Souls 1 that they had in Demon Souls, where you could just stockpile infinite amounts of HP recovery. And even when you ran out of Estus, you could just switch to using humanity, and everything was fine. You could go back to tanking any situation with your face, and it didn't matter, because you could recover all your HP 99 times 2. And on top of that, in the DLC areas, in the Artorias of the Abyss expansion, they added the Elizabeth's Mushroom, which regenerates something like 100 HP per clock tick for 60 seconds, I think. So it's the regeneration it gives you is just stupid. And when you invade, I don't remember if invaders can actually use them or not. I think they might have locked you out of being able to use Elizabeth's Mushrooms as an invader. But hosts can use them. And they really, on top of the humanity, they really kill the balance of PvP. Because if you use an Elizabeth's Mushroom, unless somebody hits you in the face with Dark Bead and does more damage than your maximum HP, an Elizabeth's Mushroom is essentially 60-second invincibility. You can just pop one, and the regeneration is so high that you can rush in, essentially, and just start swinging. And unless someone can insta-kill you in a backstab or, again, with Dark Bead, there's nothing they can do. So, well, I mean, gravity is always an option, I guess, but I don't know. If they had left out all of that crap and just had Estus be the sole source of healing other than miracles, I think they would have achieved a perfect balance of healing in Dark Souls 1. As it is, I know somebody is going to say, well, divine blessings are really limited and you only get a few Elizabeth's Mushrooms per play. Yes, but there is a way to duplicate them. And I think I might have talked about it before. And it's a really time-consuming way to duplicate them, and you have to have a friend, and at least one of you has to have a... Or it really helps if you have a PSN Plus account. But you can abuse save states of your Dark Souls 1 save file to duplicate stacks of 99 Divine Blessings and Elizabeth's Mushrooms, even without the Mega Mule, which people have asked me about before, and I'll get to that as well. This little platform here, you're meant to drop down to it from up above, and I completely forgot about it. There's the rust part of Rust and Relaxation. But, Dark Souls 2, to answer Kellen's original question, because I kind of had to explain the lead-up to that, since they've never really found a perfect balance of healing in any Souls game. But they came a lot closer to it in Dark Souls 1 than they ever got in Demon's Souls or Dark Souls 2. And the problem with Dark Souls 2 is that they essentially went back to the problem they had in Demon's Souls, where you have quite literally 12 or 13 individual stackable to 99 HP recovery items in Dark Souls 2, all of which can be farmed thanks to bonfire ascetic respawning of items lying around on corpses. And so, even before you start dumping bonfire ascetics into things, I mean, when you complete the game, or when I completed the game the first time, I had, you know, like 99 normal life gems, because you can just buy them from Valentia, 30 or 40 each radiant and old radiant life gems, a bunch of divine blessings, a bunch of monastery charms, a bunch of dragon charms, a bunch of red healing water, a bunch of the higher powered healing water, the crimson holy water. Also, when you cross that wooden bridge there, Marvelous Chester will invade you. But you can completely bypass his invasion by taking the route that I took to get the silver pendant and then coming this way. There were, what else? I think there were a couple of other healing items as well, recovery items in Dark Souls 2, but just, there were so many of the damn things that it was almost... there were, of course, Elizabeth's Mushrooms, which were toned down from Dark Souls 1, thank God, but, you had really so many different items just in your stockpile that you picked up over the course of playing the game, that even when you ran out of Estus, and even though you don't get quite as many Estus Flask charges in Dark Souls 2 as you ultimately can in Dark Souls 1, you can just, when you run out of Estus, switch to any of those other healing items that you invariably have tons of in your inventory, and go right back to tanking situations with your face. And not just tanking situations with your face, but like, going through the entire game just doing that. And in fact, you can use those other healing items and save your Estus, which activates a little bit more quickly than most of those other healing items. Save that for all the bosses and just slowly work your way through each area leading up to the boss, hiding behind a shield, and, you know, rely on your miracles or your multitude of healing items. So when people complain about the systems of healing in Dark Souls 2, that's essentially what we're talking about, is that they had an opportunity to fix that from Dark Souls 1. They had an opportunity to learn from the lessons that you would think they would have learned, you know? I would have hoped, but that they clearly did not pay any attention to, and it's one of the reasons people say that Dark Souls 2, as many steps forward as it took, it took a lot more steps backward, and the healing system is one of them. And Virginian Super Sand actually brought up a really good point that he asked me why, and I felt terrible, man. I hate to be the one putting frowns on people's faces and pointing stuff like this out, but Virginia Super Sand asked me, why did they not enable you to trade in multiple Covenant items in Dark Souls 2? They allowed you to use multiple multiple soul items. They gave you the ability to use multiple stackable soul items from your menu. And a lot of people had thought, before Dark Souls 2 came out, that maybe they would give us the ability to trade in Covenant items that way, not have to hand them in individually, and sit there for half an hour trading one Awe Stone at a time to the damn Victor's Stone. But they apparently they missed that train. Nobody on the team lead that I'm incoherent once again. None of the team leads for Dark Souls 2 thought of it. None of them thought it would be necessary, I guess. So it's really unfortunate, but that's the deal with the issues people have with the healing system in Dark Souls 2. But that said, as I've explained here, and I hope I've made this point sufficiently clear, the healing system in Dark Souls 1 and Demon's Souls were not perfect either, and really all of them were broken in one way or another. So, let me get back to my list of questions here. I have these little slips of notepad paper that I write questions down on. Sorry about that, guys. That was fairly unusual for where I live. Motorcycle noises, I usually ignore now. Sirens, quite a bit more piercing and obnoxious, and completely drown out my commentary. Yeah, an ambulance just went by, so gonna have to cut that out. There's going to be a brief pause there. Forgive me. But yeah, I write questions. I essentially go through... I read every comment you guys leave. I truly do. So if you have something to say, I will see it. But I go through the comments and I write down the ones that are... where people ask questions or raise really good points. And I have these little notepad papers that I write them down on. And I'm running out of room on the last piece of paper that I was writing on, so I had to start on a new sheet of paper. So if now or at any point in the future you hear the rustling of paper as I'm answering questions, that's why. I guess now, I guess I might as well go back to the soul memory thing, because I did want to address some of those comments as well. Been some really good discussions, and yeah, these illusory walls are an interesting thing. This one, I think there might be a message somewhere around here pointing you to it, a developer message, I don't remember. This is one that you probably would never find if you weren't already running around with the Sunlight Maggot equipped. Fortunately, though, the only thing in here is a single red Titanite chunk. And the message down below, where you get the silver pendant, that one, at least, since it's a fairly important item, they have the decency to give you a developer message there saying, giving you, I think, a fairly obvious hint of what you have to do. I forgot about this, yeah. I forgot that I had to actually roll or run or jump and not just walk off of that. But a number of people, quite a few people actually, have been discussing the potential possibilities for soul memory and the changes that they might make to it in the Game of the Year edition. And I don't have too much to say about that, but I did want to weigh in with my own opinion on what I think the most likely course of action will be. Which is quite simply that if they have any sense at all, they must realize that soul memory causes the eventual obsolescence of characters who... obsolescence for any purpose, I should say, other than PvP at the last tier of soul memory. Which I have to assume they thought was the only thing people wanted to do when they were originally designing that system. But, clearly they have a sense now that a significant number of people in the community are not happy with that. And my guess is that they will probably allow players to cap their soul memory at the minimum required to reach their current level. So if a player, for example, is soul level 150, I suspect, and a number of other people have voiced that they suspect this is going to be what's done as well, I suspect that soul level 150 character will be able to cap his soul memory so that his soul memory is only the minimum amount of souls required to reach soul level 150, whatever that is. So, I hope they do that, because that will then mean that I can create my soul level 11 build, I can go through the game and gather up whatever gear I want, and put together that build, and I will always be able to interact with other people who are in soul memory range of soul level 11. And then I'll be able to do my co-op with new players and show them the builds that I've put together that I'm very proud of, that more experienced players don't care about because they've seen everything already and it's all lost its novelty. I'll be able to go back to enjoying the game the rather out-of-the-box and unusual way that I enjoyed Demon's Souls and Dark Souls 1. But, again, I'm not just saying this because, I hope they'll do what I want, but it makes sense to be able to cap your soul memory at an equivalent to your current soul level. Because that will, if it's a self-imposed cap, it will mean that nobody has to cap it. It'll mean that people who like the system the way it is now will be able to go on enjoying it that way. And I'm all for that, you know? I'm not saying people who don't like what I like should be screwed over. If they're able to achieve a solution where everybody wins, to me, that's ideal, you know? I'm all for that. But I think that it also makes sense for the people who got used to the system in Demon Souls and Dark Souls 1, who like to be able to self-restrict their level so that their builds remain viable and they can continually interact with people in range of their own level without having to be worried about getting somebody who's soul level 838. Or conversely, you know, those people who are soul level 120 or 150 who are self-imposed capping their builds for PvP purposes, you know, every now and then they're going to get invaded by someone who's really low level, or when they invade, they'll get someone who's much lower level than they are, but has soul memory that puts them in range. And that's kind of not fair in the opposite direction. So, I don't know, I think that'd be an ideal solution. But we're going to wrap it up here, guys. Thank you for joining me, and I look forward to seeing you all next time.